So thank you. I must say that I like the music for two reasons. Number one, it makes me feel like a rock star, which is really good, because the way the Sri Lankan army has been pampering us, I think I'm really a rock star, at least for 3 days. Number one. And number two is, I know South Asian lunches are extremely dangerous. They make you fall asleep. And given that it is 3:45 in the afternoon, and we have been listening to lectures since 9 o'clock, I know that it's really going to be an extremely difficult task for me to make sure that all of you are awake. So the music really helped. So what I'll do is, I'll try to speak on West Asia, the security problems on West Asia. I have been preempted by numerous speakers from this morning onwards. So most of the themes which I thought I would really spring upon all of you and surprise you, alas, they're all gone. So I'll try to make up as I go along. And also try to be brief, because I'm really afraid of Lieutenant Colonel Galapati and the notes he bears. So I'll make sure that before he comes, I'll finish. So very quickly, what are we talking about? We are talking about West Asia, cartographic conundrum, as I point out. Again, a European construction centering around India. It was when the English came to India and they started looking from across the length and breadth of Asia by locating themselves in India, we come up with all these ideas. But this is something which has now become a part and parcel of our political lexicon. So we will go ahead with this idea. What does it really mean? In fact, it really means a lot. So as you can see, geographically, Western Asia includes the Levant. It includes the Arabian Peninsula. It includes Anatolia, Iran, and the Armenian highlands. Sinai also belongs to Western Asia, making Egypt a transcontinental country. So we can also bring in Egypt when we talk about West Asia. So as you can see, 19 countries make up the region, which makes my task extremely difficult, but because I'm sure if I spare 1 minute for each country, that will mean 19 minutes, and Colonel Galapati is not going to give me that time, so we will not talk about all these countries. So this is my take. My take is different countries and varying contexts leads to a plethora of national security issues. Yesterday evening at the wonderful reception we were having, I was talking with this honorable gentleman, and he was asking me that what are the issues you are bringing up? Are you talking about Iran? Are you talking about what is happening in various parts of the Middle East? And of course, the Arab-Israeli problem. And I had to say in embarrassment that no, I'm not talking about any of these things. The reason is very simple. I'm not talking about these things because I know these are extremely important, but it will be very difficult to go through these issues within the time stipulated to me. But instead, what I'll do is I'll try to look at some of the issues which are becoming increasingly prominent for understanding the insecurity which the region is facing, try to apply them, throw in a few examples so that things become easy for us. But a word of caution, and this is the problem with international relations, which also makes my task somewhat easier because I can always get away with things. When it comes to security, just when you think that you know the answer, they change the question. This happened particularly with the end of the Cold War. We were all set. We were looking at all these ideas, traditional balance of power, unipolarity, bipolarity, East-West confrontation. Things were really good. In fact, His Excellency President Hamid Karzai was pointing out this morning that maybe we need to go back to a balance of power scenario. So this is something which was there. But lo and behold, all of a sudden, you have the collapse of Soviet Union, and you really don't know. In fact, none of us know where we are right now. So this is the problem we are facing. And I think this is something which you will be facing more in the days ahead. You identify certain problems. You think that you are nearing the problem. You have got all the necessary knowledge and the means of dealing with the problem. But suddenly, all of a sudden, the problem mutates. It turns into something very different. So we have to be careful about this. So what are the big drivers as far as West Asian security is concerned? Number one, more than important than anything else, is of course the concept of failing states and state wannabe non-state actors. I seek apology for my non-academic language, particularly using American-style state wannabe non-state actors, but I think it really sums up the situation which we are noticing in West Asia right now. quite a few Western states have failed or are teetering on the edge of the abyss. Syria, Iraq, and Yemen naturally comes to mind. And we have been talking about this from this morning onwards. At the same time, we are seeing a paradox. We are seeing a paradox in the sense that there are non-state actors who are trying to become state actors. So again, try to understand the scenario. On the one hand, states are falling apart. On the other hand, you have non-state actors who are increasingly taking up the responsibility or who are increasingly acting as if they are states. So I talk about ISIS or ISIL, the Houthis of Yemen, Hezbollah in Lebanon. These are all a part of the canvas. So what exactly does a state need to survive, and what brought West Asian states to the brink of collapse? And this is something which I think is very important for us to understand. We know this. We know this because we have studied political science, 101, basic. But this is something we tend to forget, given the load of information which the media throws upon us. Please, ladies and gentlemen, I would request you to remember three things when it comes to dealing with states. Number one, the most important factor as far as states are concerned is that they must be providers of law and order. So state stability, to a great extent, is dependent on its ability to project power over population through its institutions, functions, and actions. Let me go through them one by one very quickly. Firstly, the state must have control, and be able to coerce its population. In other words, a classic Weberian definition of state. The state must have monopoly over the means of coercion within its territory, number one. Number two, but it is not about coercive ability. It is about something else. All states have coercive ability. Even the most good states, if you look at the Norwegian state, the Nordic states, of course, coercive element is present there. But in front of that coercive element, you have a sort of a velvet glove, if I can use the old example. So you must have an iron hand with which you can rule the state. But most of the time, this iron hand must be within a glove. It should be within a velvet glove. So it should be able to deliver services citizens need into their day-to-day lives and develop the infrastructure to do so. So this is something extremely important, and we tend to forget this most of the time. And third, and also very important, the state must ideologically bind itself to its population, so it should bring the population together, and at the same time, it should make sure that the population identify themselves with the state. A lot of time, we see this not happening. In other words, the nation-building process has failed in a lot of these areas, and this is something which we need to consider. So very quickly, I will go through them. Number one, why is this so important? It is important because without having control over the means of violence, it becomes extremely difficult for the state to be able to implement its will over the people. What happens when the state loses its power to coerce the people? Well, what happens is people do look for security, and it is when this vacuum is created that non-state actors, President Karzai was talking about it this morning, ethnic and religious entrepreneurs, they come in, and these are entrepreneurs, really, ladies and gentlemen. So they come in, they tap into these discontents, and ultimately, they try to bring over the people to their side. So the state must have the ability to coerce its people, number one. But number two, equally important, if the state is not able to provide services to the people, if you're not able to provide them with jobs, with electricity, I remember Professor Koka talking about this this morning when he pointed out the difficulty the Iraqi government faced with soaring temperature and the lack of air conditioning. This is what we are talking about. Electricity becomes suddenly very important. Clean water suddenly becomes extremely important. And if you're not able to deliver any of these, then of course these non-state actors, these political, religious, and ethnic entrepreneurs, they take advantage of this. And these, as I said, these are really entrepreneurs. They move with the wind. They're extremely pragmatic. And I'll give you one example. ISIL has been using water as a means through which they're able to control allegiance in the areas they control. So just think, ladies and gentlemen, basic amenity, water. Water suddenly has become a weapon in this fight against terror. So we need to take these into consideration. And the last which I have already pointed out, the state must be there as far as the people are concerned. So we constantly need to flag the state. We should be able to tell the people that, look, we are here for you. The state is here for you. It should be ingrained in their day-to-day lives. Without that, the people will not give their allegiance to the state. And this, again, leads to non-state actors coming and filling up the gap. So what are the other problems which we are facing in the Middle East, or North, or West Asia, rather? There's not enough land, and there's not enough water. Again, this is something very important. We need to take this into consideration. And I draw your attention to a seminal article which has just come out. It came out in March 2015, Proceedings of the National Academy of Science of United States of America, where the authors argue that, again, Professor Coker has preempted me on this, drought is one of the factors, is one of the drivers as far as the Syrian conflict is concerned. We tend to forget this. We tend to think of Syria as of course, it's a civil war. There is a multitude of actors carving out their own agenda over there. But let us not forget that the environment has played havoc as far as Syria is concerned. The drought, which is one of the worst of the 20th, in fact, from the beginning of the 20th century onwards, water supplies in Syria has been drying up. In the last 25 years, three of the five worst droughts in recent memory, they have hit Syria. And the current one, which started in 2005, and it continued to 2007-8 until 2012, this was one of the worst droughts ever recorded in the history of Syria. So what does it mean? It means that people were forced to move. People ultimately moved to cities which were already under severe stress because of the huge influx of Iraqi refugees fleeing another war across the Syrian-Iraq border. So you have a combustible scenario where people are coming in from the villages, farmers, the state is unable to provide them with the necessary facilities, and on top of that, you already have refugees. Now, I want to draw your attention to the three points which I have just made in the previous slide. Just think about it. The state is unable to provide benefits to its people. The people no longer identify themselves with the state. Of course, this doesn't mean automatically. We cannot draw a single line saying that environmental issues have automatically led to conflicts. We never say that. But what I'm trying to tell you is that when you think about these conflicts, when you try to make sense of these conflicts, please do take them into consideration. Yemen is a classic example of what is happening right now, where everything, unfortunately, has come together. It's a deadly concoction. Yemen was collapsing even before the current uprising, and it was collapsing because of plummeting less water and economic resources that aggravated regional and tribal divisions and rickety governance structures. I'll give you, this is a classic example, really, a doomsday scenario. Yemen's population of 23 million. Coming from Bangladesh, which has about 160 million people, 23 million is really nothing. I mean, this is second division football, as they say. But given Yemen's realities, 23 million is a lot. And nearly half of them are under the age of 15, and is expected to and the population is expected to double by 2035. Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to remember this particular point, because I'm going to come back to this later on. So the economically hard-pressed country faces an environmental crisis. Experts fear that Sana, which is a World Heritage Site, will not be destroyed by ISIL, but it is Yemen's realities which will destroy Sana. So if the current rate continues, by 2025, the city's projected 4.2 million people will become water refugees. Sana will be the world's first capital to be deserted because of environmental degradation, because of lack of water. So with little being done to harness rainfall in the country, farmers are drilling deeper and deeper without any regulation. Agriculture uses around 90% of the country's water resources, with around half being used to cultivate the herbal stimulant, khat or khat, as they say. And of course, since this brings in money, it means that more and more land is brought under khat cultivation every year. Displacing, again, look at how all these bad things come together. It means that tens of thousands of hectares of vital crops, fruits, vegetable, coffee — Yemen is one of the world's best producer of coffee — leading to all these are gradually pushed away. So which means, and Colonel Galapati is coming, so I'll be very quick. So leading to food price hike, and of course resulting social, economic, economic tensions. So under the circumstances, Yemen finds it very difficult to maintain control over and legitimacy over its tribal entities, which leads to pockets of ungoverned spaces, creating opportunities for extremists to exploit economic and political changes. I will skip this, but again, the reality is the same. The same reality also applies for Nigeria. In Nigeria, you will constantly see conflicts breaking out. It's not only the Boko Haram, but conflicts breaking out between various tribes, between pastoralists and farmers. Global warming, to a great extent, is responsible for that. Peacekeepers, those who have served in Mali, for example, you will know that Mali is a classic example, particularly northern Mali, where environmental degradation, the fact that the Gulf of Guinea is losing, the temperature is changing over there, you have less and less precipitation, and the Sahara is going southwards, it is increasing every year by miles and miles. All this is leading to a scenario where countries are facing it extremely difficult for the state to be able to cope with these realities, because it also means food shortage, it also means people are ultimately moving away from land. So the northern Sahel region has been extremely hard hit and will put great strains on the population and society in northern Mali and increase the potential. Another problem which you want to take into consideration when you think about West Europe is, of course, the youth bulge. 2/3 of the population is under the age of 30. How are you going to provide for them? Because I'm going to give you another doomsday scenario. So bear with me. This is the problem. Your economy is dependent on oil. But is it a curse or is it a cure? Two things have happened recently, and we should be concerned about this. Number one, we are seeing developments taking place in the field of oil production. You see two new ways of bringing in more and more oil: horizontal drilling, which allows wells to penetrate bands of shale deep underground, and hydraulic fracturing, or fracking, as they say, which allows the injection of high pressure fluid to release gas and oil from rock formations. So what does this mean? The speaker before me, Lady Olga, she has already pointed this out. Are we seeing changes as far as global politics is concerned? Because powers who were dependent on oil as a source of their power, these countries are going to face a difficult reality in the days ahead. So as producers tap unconventional gas and oil resources around the world, from the waters of Australia, Brazil, Africa, and the Mediterranean to the oil sands of Alberta and United States, what does it mean for countries of West Asia, which of course are dependent on oil? So this means that these countries are going to be facing a bind in the days ahead. It's going to face a bind because, please let us not forget, there is something called break-even price as far as oil is concerned. So the price which you are incurring as a result of production of oil and how much you are able and to what extent you are able to sell that. So the difference between that is really something which you can hold on to. But if you are looking at a scenario where the amount of money you are getting from oil price is getting lower and lower, and at the same time, you have a huge number of young people coming up, how are you going to provide for them? So you, as a policy planner in most of these West Asian countries, if I were you, I would be losing sleep every night. Why? Because this is the reality. The reality is that the World Bank has forecasted that we need about 100 million job opportunities to be created in West Asia and North Africa by 2020 in order to absorb the next baby boomer generation. But is that possible? It may be possible, but we have to be extremely pragmatic about this, and history plays an important role over here. Look at the difference between Spain and, of course, Great Britain. Spain, dependent on the riches of South America, ultimately gradually declined. Of course, it was maybe a comfortable decline, but it did go into a decline. England, on the other hand, as we all know, particularly, technology is something which you should never depend upon because it seems it is not working right now. So I'll be very quick. Britain, on the other hand, was able to tap into its entrepreneurial skills and able to create an empire. And of course, we ourselves are a reflection of that. So for the Arab countries, for the West Asian countries, this is something which they need to take into consideration. How are they going to proceed in the days ahead? How are they going to deal with this challenge? Because most of these countries have not lived up to the expectations of their unemployed younger generation, and question comes as to what they can offer the next generation. And let us not forget, ladies and gentlemen, as we have all been noticing since this morning onwards, this is a generation which knows how to use cell phones, smartphones, and of course Facebook, as I can see all of you are using right now. So, where do I go from here? It's not working. Okay, so this is the last slide, so bear with me. So I end with this again. I follow Professor Coker to some extent. I end with a pessimistic note, unfortunately. I end with a pessimistic note. So this is the denouement, as they say. From one of my favorite authors, Stefan Zweig, who wrote The World of Yesterday and The Man Who Committed Suicide just as the Second World War was coming to an end. He talks about the First World War, he talks about the Second World War. He points out that the war of 1913 had a spiritual meaning, a question of freedom and the preservation of moral possessions. And to fight for an idea makes man hard and determined. The war of 1914, on the other hand, knew nothing of the realities. It still served a delusion, the dream of a better, righteous, and peaceful world. And it is only delusion and not knowledge that bestows happiness. Whether we want to be happy and not think about the future, or whether we want to be pessimistic and think deeply about the future and take some measures to deal with these realities, this is something which is, I think, you need to take up the challenge. So thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for listening to me.